We're so thankful to start this worship this morning at Second Presbyterian with these great hymns of the faith that you have chosen, and thank you for all of your submissions. We're also thankful to have Steve Taylor on violin and Michael Schroeder on mandolin and, of course, Marshall Roberts on piano. Enjoy these great hymns of the faith and sing along with us.
Thank you. welcome you to worship here at Second Presbyterian Church. Wherever you are watching us or whenever you are watching us, we are grateful that you are with us. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God.
The Word of Life.
The Font of Identity.
And the Table of Sustenance. Children of God, welcome home.
Because we trust in God's covenant faithfulness, we are free to make our confession to God and call for his compassion. Let us, therefore, confess our sins, that we may be renewed in his grace. Let us go to God in prayer using the response, "In our mercy, forgive us." God of wisdom and mercy, you have created a world of beauty, a world where each person has an honored place in your love. But we do not always honor ourselves or one another as your beloved people. O God, for all the times when we have known of the suffering of others but turned away from it, in your mercy, forgive us. O God, help us to see clearly and follow your will, for some of us have seen pain and blamed it on those who suffer. In your mercy, forgive us. Creator God, open our eyes so that we may see your image in others' faces and recognize them as your beloved children. And God, for all the times when we alone or as a church have not sought to bring about your justice, in your mercy, forgive us. Hear this good news. Our ever faithful God has forgiven and freed us to love and serve. Thanks be to God. Amen. Continue our sermon series, Story I Thought I Knew, we concentrate on another famous story of the Bible, the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We so appreciate the Hughes family who brings us that story today. Please pray with me. Lord God, may your word be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Today's lesson is about a king named Nebuchadnezzar and three funny named men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. King Nebuchadnezzar's army had defeated the Israelites. Now that he was their ruler, King Nebuchadnezzar built a golden statue. He made a bad law. It said, when the music plays, everyone must bow to the statue and worship the statue. Those who disobey will be thrown into the fiery furnace. The music began to play. The people fell down and worshiped the statue, but Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused. We only worship the true God, they said. The king was mad. The king said, make the furnace extra hot. He had the men thrown aside. Yet, when he looked into the furnace, there were four men walking around. One of them looked like an angel from God. The king shouted to the men, come out! Your God has saved you. The fire did not hurt them. They did not even smell like smoke, he said to all the people. Praise to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. No other God can save people this way, and the king made them rulers of his kingdom. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Continue in our sermon series, Stories I Thought I Knew, with this familiar story that we've already heard, read from Daniel chapter 3. Listen now once more for the word of the Lord. King Nebuchadnezzar made a golden statue whose height was 60 cubits, whose width was 6 cubits. He set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then King Nebuchadnezzar sent for the satraps, the prefects, and the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the justices, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces to assemble and come to the dedication of the statue. So they came. When they were standing before the statue, the herald proclaimed, you are commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages, that when you hear the sound of the horn, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the drum, and the entire musical ensemble, you should fall down and worship the golden statue. And whoever does not fall down will be thrown into a furnace of blazing fire. Therefore, as soon as the people heard the music, they fell down and worshiped. Now, at the same time, certain Chaldeans came forward and denounced the Jews, saying, there are some, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who pay no heed to you, O king. They do not serve your gods, and they do not worship the statue. Nebuchadnezzar, in a furious rage, commanded that they be brought before him. And he said to them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods and you do not worship the golden statue that I have set up? But I will give you another chance. And if you do not worship, you shall immediately be thrown into the furnace. And who is the God that will deliver you out of my hands?" They answered the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to present a defense to you. If our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us out from the furnace of blazing fire and out of your hand, O king, then let him deliver us. But if not, be it known to you that we will not serve your gods and we will not worship the golden statue that you have set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar was so filled with rage that his face was distorted, and he ordered the furnace heated up 7 times. Because the king's command was urgent and the furnace was so overheated, the raging flames killed the men who lifted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But the 3 men fell down bound into the furnace of blazing fire. Then the king was astonished and rose up quickly. He said, "Was it not 3 that were bound and thrown into the fire?" They answered, "True, O king." And he replied, "But I see 4 unbound men walking in the middle of the fire, and they are not hurt, and the 4th has the appearance of an angel." Nebuchadnezzar approached the door and said, "Servants of the Most High God, come out, come here." And so they came. And not a single hair on their head had been singed. Their tunics were not harmed, and not even the smell of fire was on them. And Nebuchadnezzar said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him. They disobeyed the king's command and yielded their bodies rather than serve and worship any god except their own. Therefore, I make a decree, any people, nation, or language that utters blasphemy against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be torn limb for limb and their houses laid in ruin, for there is no other God who is able to deliver in this way." And the king promoted them in the province of Babylon. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be found pleasing and acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Matilda is a famous children's book by beloved author Roald Dahl. It's been turned into a movie, a Broadway musical, an animated television series, perhaps one of his most famous stories. And it centers around the main character, Matilda, a young girl with telekinetic abilities who is ignored and misunderstood by her parents and despised by her ruthless and tyrannical principal, Mrs. Trunchbull. And in one of the best scenes in the movie, or at least my favorite scene in the movie, her friend Bruce is caught eating a piece of cake by the cook. So Principal Trunchbull calls an all-school assembly. And Bruce is sitting in front of everyone. And she says to him, "You wanted cake. You got cake. Now eat cake!" He's forced to eat this enormous chocolate cake. And right when we think he's going to pass out or at least throw up because he's eaten so much cake, his friend Matilda stands up to encourage him. She says, "You can do it, Bruce." And all the other kids stand up, chanting, "Bruce, Bruce, Bruce." Now, of course, Mrs. Trunchbull is furious and she begins to try to quiet the crowd, but it's too late. Bruce rallies, he eats the cake, even licking the platter in triumph. Her discipline has failed. Mrs. Trunchbull has been outsmarted and outplayed by these children. Often a theme in Dahl's books, how much smarter children are than the adults. Either way, she is furious, and she becomes even more ruthless. This is not an unfamiliar story. We love this kind of story, the little guy, the underdog, overcoming the powerful. It is written into our folklore, our myths, our movies, and even into our national history. It is also our story for this morning. We heard the story read and told to us, and perhaps it is familiar for you. It's a pretty simple story. There's a king who wants to show how powerful he is, so he creates this statue. He builds an idol to himself and requires everyone to bow down and worship. But while there's this going on, there's a subplot about a people named the Hebrews, the Jews. They'd been captured and taken into exile. They are living among the Babylonians. And there were four in particular. The chapter 1, the book of Daniel, tells us about Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. But they are given new names. Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Balthazar. To be reminded that they are no longer Jews, but they are foreigners living as exiles. So this edict comes out to worship, and a plot begins. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refuse to worship. They are defiant. They resist this order. It causes the king to become angry, to turn the furnace 7 times hotter, to be thrown into the fire. But there's a fourth person in the fire with them, and they are not burned, and the king is amazed. He pulls them out, and he declares that no one can say a word against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. As a kid, I loved this story. Perhaps you did as well. The bravery of these three friends standing up for what they knew to be right, even if it meant losing their lives. The bravery and the courage and the faith that it took was astounding. But as I've gotten older, I've begun to see this story a bit differently. Scripture and the stories of our faith are like that, right? They change as we change. We can see them from many different sides and perspectives. And for me, this story has taken on a different shape, a different color. It has become more, for me, about God's action. As a child, I sort of assumed that God would save them, right? But for now, for me right now, I see God's faithfulness in this story in real and profound ways. God's showing up is what really strikes me. In fact, you can see this in their response to the king. They say, "If our God, who is able to save us, then let God save us. But if not, even still, we will not bow." What faith, what defiance, if, not will, but if God can. They know that God might not, and it does not matter to them. They know who the God they serve is, and they know that this king has no power over them because this king has no power over death. No power over God's love for them. It is this defiance and this faith that has helped me to see to some extent that perhaps this is not my story. I've not ever lived this reality. I don't know what it would be like to have to be defiant to a king. Never had to stand up for my faith in this kind of way. Ultimately, that's what this story is about. It's about power and those who live under it in oppression. And it might seem to us like a fanciful story, like something from a fairy tale or children's story. The absurdity of a king making himself into a god. And yet, this story has continued to play itself out over and over in history. It is no wonder that Martin Luther King Jr. will reference this story in his letter from a Birmingham jail while appealing to white pastors to use their power to help in the civil rights movement. Resistance, civil disobedience, that is what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego do. They defy the rules. And these are easy words to say, but very difficult to live out in real life and make me just a little bit uncomfortable. Because the truth is that for most of my life, I've never been in a position like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. More often, I've been in a position of having power. And power is a strange thing, right? It reveals something about who we really are. You want to see a person's integrity. Give them just a little bit of power and see what they do with it. We see this play out all the time on playgrounds and in teams and in high schools. When you're given power, do you use it with compassion, grace, and love? Or are you like Nebuchadnezzar, obsessed with the world knowing that you have it? In fact, in this story, we know that it was written much, much later. And most scholars agree that it is a retelling of something that happened in the past to speak to a present moment. You see, the Jews were living under Greek rule this time. And a current group of Jews were experiencing persecution once more. They were exiles, people in a foreign land living under a foreign rule. They have no power. So they write down this story in Daniel to remind them of God's action in the past, knowing that God will act again. It is also a funny story written with intentional humor. The repetitive of the lists and the absurdity of the requests by the king, the size of the statue, they're all told to cue the reader in to just how absurd this king is over against the God of Israel. There's a reason that we love humor. And in particular, political humor. The history of political cartoons in our country is well known. Or on satire shows like Saturday Night Live, whether it's Dana Carvey's George W. Bush, or Will Ferrell's Bush, or Larry David's Bernie Sanders. Humor. It's a way to control a situation in which you have no control. The Jews in both Babylon and in Greece have no power to change their current moment, but they know the truth about who God is, what God has done. God has been and is and will be faithful. That is God's promise, and they know that to be true even in the midst of their oppression. They are not afraid. Because as the Apostle Paul will write much later, if God is for us, then who or what can be against us? In his book, Jesus in the Disinherited, one of the most famous preachers of the past 50 years, Howard Thurman, tells this story. He says, "When I was a small boy, Halley's Comet visited our solar system. And one night I was awakened by my mother, who told me to dress quickly and come with her into the backyard. I shall never forget it if I live forever. My mother stood with me, with her hand resting on my shoulder, while I, in utter speechless awe, beheld the great spectacle with its fan of light spreading across the heavens. The silence was like that of absolute motion. And finally, after what seemed to me an interminable time interval, I found my speech. What will happen to us if that comet falls out of the sky? My mother's silence was so long that I looked from the comet to her face, and there I beheld something in her countenance, something that I had only seen once before when I found her in prayer. And she said to me, "Howard, nothing will happen to us because God will care for us." Oh, simple-hearted mother of mine, in one glorious moment, you put your heart on to the ultimate affirmation of the human spirit. Many things have I seen since that night. Times without number, I have learned that life is hard as crucible steel. But as years have unfolded, the majestic power of my mother's words have come back again and again, beating out its rhythmic chant in my own spirit. Here are the faith and awareness that overcome fear and transform it into the power to strive, to achieve, and not to yield. Not to yield to the fire. While we ourselves might not be asked to kneel to a king, we all have our own fire that we must fight. We all have our own fears that we must tackle. What fires, what fear do we experience in our own lives? Well, there are actual fires burning right now. The western part of our nation, in our prayers, are with those in California and Colorado, all who've been affected. Our prayers are with those who've been affected by yet another hurricane. And we find ourselves living in the midst of a global pandemic because of the novel coronavirus and the fire that continues to rage, both here and around the world. I was speaking with our mission partners in El Salvador and Costa Rica this week, and they were sharing how devastating COVID-19 has been for those in the most vulnerable communities. And it shows no signs of slowing down there anytime soon. And this fire feels just like the furnace of Daniel 3 being turned up 7 times hotter. Perhaps we are experiencing other kinds of fire in our own lives. The fire of a broken and hurt relationship. The fire of cancer and sickness or addiction, unemployment. Perhaps you are parents trying to work from home while also helping your kids do NTI in the basement or the living room, and it feels like your life is literally on fire. Whether it's your patience or your marriage or your parenting, you just feel stretched like you can't go anymore. And the thing is, while we perhaps have never had to decide, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, whether to bow, we have all experienced our own fiery furnace. And we hope in this story that God shows up in our lives, in our moments. But the truth is that even if God doesn't show up, the three friends know who God is, who God has shown God's self to be over and over again. For I am convinced that nothing in all of creation can separate us from God's love. I belong in life and death, body and soul, the catechism reminds us. So we can face the fire when it comes because we know that we never face it alone. There is always someone in the fire with us. Commentators have argued for centuries about this fourth person in the fire. Who is it? In some ways, I don't think it matters because it reveals to us that we are not alone. Perhaps that fourth person was an angel or a messenger of God. Perhaps it was Jesus Christ himself, or perhaps it was a neighbor or a friend or a family member. Maybe it was a deacon of the church bringing a casserole, or a friend calling to check in on you, or someone you barely know giving you money because they know you couldn't make rent this month. God shows up over and over again in our lives. We are never alone. This is the promise of the story. This is why they wrote it when they wrote it. Because in the midst of the chaos, of the oppression, the pain of their current moment, the people of God needed to be reminded that God had provided, that God was faithful, and that God would be faithful again. Perhaps they didn't have to be afraid. Because this God that they serve, that we serve, is bigger than death itself. Friends, we might see fire, but we know that we do not see it alone, and that this God is able to save us, and that this God is with us. Because God has already saved us in Jesus Christ. And God is already with us right now. That is our promise. That is our hope. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us join together to affirm our faith. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him, God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. Amen.
Peace.
is Promotion Sunday. And in a non-pandemic world, we would be inviting all our children back from the summer, and they would get to go to their new Sunday school class and meet their new Sunday school teachers. Although we can't be together in Sunday school, we do want to point out a few milestones that we have that we want to make sure are recognized this morning. Each three-year-old is invited to Sunday school, and they are given this beginner's Bible. And our three-year-olds who will receive this Bible this year are Sylvia Masick, McLean Watkins, Hurston Heil, Francis Hines, Cameron Irving, Elizabeth Judy, Charlotte Kenny, and Parker Saylor. Another milestone that is reached is in fourth grade, when you enter Club 45 now, and you are given the Deep Blue Kids Bible. This is the first study Bible you receive in our church. And those fourth graders this year are Zachary Burris, Caroline Baker, Paul Erickson, Hunter Libby, Lucas Teague, and Isabella Waterfield. Will you please join me in praying over these Bibles and for these students? Blessed be your name, O Lord our God. You are the fount and source of every blessing. You have revealed yourself to your human creation in many diverse ways. Look upon us today as we renew our commitment to read and remember you. Help us to absorb wisdom and live in truth. Encourage us with the help of the Holy Spirit to use these sacred writings for our prayer and inspiration, for the increase of our own faith and devotion. Through your word, may we be transformed into the very likeness of Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you forever and ever. Amen.
We have a couple of announcements to share with you about what is going on in the life of the church. Grief groups, which are led by Elizabeth Clay, are starting back up. The first group, which is meeting on Tuesday, September 1st, is focused on the loss of a loved one. And the second group, which is meeting on Monday, September 7th, is focused on other life losses. If you are interested in either one of those or would like to know more about them, then contact Elizabeth Clay. Sunday school is starting back up, and one of our classes this fall is on the Enneagram, which is a tool to help you learn more about yourself and your relationships with others. And the deadline to sign up for that class is September 4th. So if you're interested, reach out to Sharon Stern. Wednesdays Together starts back September 16th. We are very excited to see you all there. And there are classes for all age groups at Wednesdays Together. And there was an email that was sent out a couple of weeks ago telling you how we are doing Wednesdays Together safely. So I direct your attention to that. We continue to support our mission partners through your generous gifts through the COVID fund. And if you have not yet donated but still would like to, there still is time, and you can do so on our website. Thank you for your generosity, and we have a video from one of our mission partners saying thank you.
Hi, I'm Rob Locke, CEO of Habitat for Humanity in Metro Louisville. I appreciate the opportunity to share a little about Habitat Louisville and to thank you for your continued support. For over 26 years, Presbyterians have supported Habitat through build sponsorships and volunteers. This year, Presbyterians will welcome the 31st family on the path to homeownership. Presbyterian churches have directly impacted the lives of over 60 children, providing affordable and stable homes for family meals, sleepovers, holiday celebrations, and a lifetime of memories. Today, we are here at Habitat headquarters, and behind us, we've got an applicant for Habitat. It's the first, the second day of our open enrollment period. And yesterday, we had 91 different families come through and ask for applications for Habitat's program. With all the craziness that's going on, affordable housing has never been more important. I think about the reality of my family and having four people that haven't lived together in quite a long time, but each of us has our own bedroom. We have space. Imagine if you were in those circumstances with lots of people and the roof's leaking and you don't know where the rent's coming from. So Habitat's not dishing out free stuff. We're giving people an opportunity to climb a ladder, fix the rungs of the ladder, to climb to a better place for themselves and their kids. So as we find ourselves in a worldwide pandemic, your support is vital to the continuation of our mission, where every family has a decent place to live. Due to COVID-19 and physical distancing guidelines, Habitat's costs have increased and our ability to utilize volunteers has decreased. Construction staff and a small number of volunteers have continued to work on our homes and move things forward. So we're not stopping, we're keeping on. And we've had to use more subcontractors for jobs we normally complete with volunteers, and this cost has approached as much as $20,000 on some houses. So we originally had hoped to do 22 homes. Now our goal is 19 houses this year in terms of investment projects. And partnerships like yours with Presbyterian churches are absolutely crucial. We look forward to the day when we can share fellowship on Raise the Roof again. I know it's coming. I have faith that we'll be there next year as God is good. And we will share one of those awesome church potluck lunches together. But for now, your prayers and your financial support will help guide Habitat through these tough times. We hope to see some of you at the build site in Park Springs in October. But from all of us at Habitat and from Mofak and Yasmin, our home buyers, thank you for helping us build today for a brighter tomorrow.
Now, let us turn our hearts and minds to God as we pray using the response, God of grace, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Loving and healing God, we turn to you in prayer, confident that you are with us and with all people in every moment. We stand before you as a people of hope, trusting in your care and protection. May your faithful love support us and soothe our anxieties. And God, when we do have doubts of your faithfulness and care for our world, remind us of the confidence of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We know that there are so many people who may feel as if they are being put into a fiery furnace to test their trust and faithfulness to you. Remind us that you are with us through our fiery trials in life. God of grace, hear our prayers. Generous God, fill us with compassion and concern for others, young and old, that we may look after one another in these challenging days. Bring peace and comfort to all those that are affected by this pandemic, wildfires and hurricanes, and the injustices in our world. God of grace, hear our prayer. O God of creation and life, we place ourselves in your protection. May we feel your love and your peace enfold us this day and tomorrow. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, let us now go out into the world, knowing and believing and trusting that nothing is going to happen to us, because God will take care of us. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us from this day and forevermore. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.